think we may have more people joining us in a few minutes, but we will go ahead and get started. So I want to thank you all for joining us for today's workshop, NEH Awards and More, Strategies for Becoming Involved in NEH Funded Projects. I'm Amanda Swain, and I co-direct the UC Irvine Humanities Center with Judy Wu, Professor of Asian American Studies. And I want to welcome my colleagues who are here from UC Irvine with this workshop, and also our regional colleagues. We have folks who registered and hopefully are here from UCLA, UC San Diego, USC, Chapman University, Cal State, Northridge, Harvey Mudd College. And there are also people who registered from farther afield. So we have a national representation of this workshop as well. But most of all, I want to welcome Jennifer Cerventi, who is here to talk to us today about NEH grants and other opportunities at the NEH. She is a senior program officer in the Office of Digital Humanities. And prior to joining the Office of Digital Humanities in 2007, she served in NEH's Division of Research and Education Programs. So she has long experience at the NEH and knows a lot about their programs kind of across the various divisions, and can talk about lots of different opportunities at the NEH, and in particular to fund digital projects, but not just digital projects. Jennifer is also one of our own. She received her BA in History and Government from Claremont McKenna College in Claremont, California. So she has connections here to Southern California. And she is one of my last pre-COVID isolation human contacts. A year ago, last week, I was actually at the NEH meeting with Jennifer and several other NEH program officers at the NEH offices. We were sanitizing our hands and bumping elbows and thought that that was what we need to do to stay safe from coronavirus. But it was a wonderful opportunity, as the NEH program officers are always very generous with their time and their knowledge and their wisdom to talk about their programs and projects and how to best apply for funding. So we're thrilled to have Jennifer with us virtually today. And so I will turn it over to you.
Thank you, Amanda. So 1 year ago, or as it's now known, a decade ago, basically, as we think about how time has flown this last year, but also dragged. And yet, the NEH is still here. We're still funding excellent work in the humanities. And so I'm thrilled that that you are willing to host me to talk about our funding opportunities. And before I begin, I do want to thank both Amanda and Ryan, for both from UC Irvine, for doing the hard work to set up this this workshop. These things don't happen without a lot of infrastructure to go into it. And Ryan and Amanda have been really wonderful in making sure that they've been checking in with me, making sure that we've talked about publicity strategies. They've made this all happen. So thank you to them. It couldn't have happened without both of you. But today I'm going to spend a little bit of time talking about NEH funding opportunities across the endowment, and then talk a little bit about application strategies, and then other ways to become involved with NEH and to keep up with what we're doing, with an eye toward establishing a relationship with you all, to make sure that you know that we're never just one and done at NEH. If you're in the humanities, or if you're working in humanities adjacent fields, the NEH should always be on your radar screen. But let's get started. Let's see. There we go. The first question that I often get from my family, although now that I've been working at the NEH for 27 years, I think I've brought them into the fold. What is the humanities? What are the humanities? We do actually have a definition that guides us. This is from our enabling legislation in 1965. And it is basically a laundry list of disciplines. But having said that, it's more than just a laundry list of disciplines. It's a way of doing your work. It's a way of modeling appropriate of modes of thinking or appropriate ways of approaching your work. It's a very capacious definition. It seems to work well. It includes, obviously, those aspects of the social scientists, which have humanistic components or that employ humanistic methods. It also includes things like science and technology studies, linguistics, which is one of those disciplines that straddles, anthropology, archaeology, also those straddling disciplines, criticism and theory of the arts, another sort of discipline that we share with our colleagues at our sister agency, the National Endowment for the Arts, which is to say, we probably can find a space for you at the NEH somewhere, depending on what you're doing and the types of questions that you're asking. And if not, we'll try to refer you to the right funding agency if we're not it. But right now, this is our governing legislation for what the humanities are. So I always like to start my presentations with the definition that guides us. Since 1965, when one began, and this is just from a month ago, I just checked our database today, these are the announced awards that we have supported over the years. So more than 66,000, we're approaching 67,000. And can I get a quick sort of reaction using the reactions button? How many of you have benefited from an NEH-funded project? If you could sort of use the raise your hands feature, that would be really helpful. So I'm seeing a few raised hands. And yet, I would argue that all of you have benefited from an NEH-funded project, whether it be you have had you have used resources that NEH has supported the preservation of, you have watched a documentary on PBS, you have been taught by a teacher who attended an NEH Summer Seminar Institute, or a family member has attended a Summer Seminar Institute, or have been taught by someone who decided to stay in the teaching profession because they attended a Summer Seminar Institute. So the NEH is broad, it's deep, and it touches every American's lives, and we work very hard to make sure that's the case. So, and it encompasses not just American history topics, it encompasses projects around the world from the prehistoric era, or just right after the prehistoric era, to the contemporary times. So, which is once again to say, see yourself in the NEH as well, because you have benefited from it and you may in fact benefit from it in the future. So the way the NEH is organized as a funding agency, because that's what you're here for. We do lots of things. We have a magazine. We do other sort of interviews and whatnot, but primarily we are a federal funding agency to support work in the humanities. That is our mission. We have 7 grant programs and grant divisions and offices at the NEH, and I'm going to spend my time though talking about 4 of them. Based on sort of where you all are from, I'm taking a guess that these are the 4 offices and divisions that you may be most interested in, but I'm happy to field questions in the chat during for all of the offices and divisions. One nice thing about working for a very small federal agency is I know my colleagues in other offices and divisions, and I also know the programs in other offices and divisions as well. But I am with the Office of Digital Humanities. It is the youngest of the 7 offices and divisions. We are now a teenager. We are now 16 years old. Which is to say, though, that the Office of Digital Humanities is not the only place that supports digital projects. I like to think of digital projects as being on a spectrum and fitting in perhaps lots of different places at the NEH. And because of that, we have actually written a blog post that we just updated in January to help guide you through the different opportunities. It's also to say that depending on your project, you may start with one division and then move to another division for support at a later stage, or you may break your project into pieces that may go into different funding streams. And that's okay. That's always been okay, whether it was not a digital project. And in fact, the National Endowment for the Humanities has supported digital projects before there was really a public-facing internet. If you look at our enabling legislation, it mentions technology. We have supported lots of early work. In 1967, we were one of the first supporters of what became EDUCAUSE. We were the early supporters of the Text and Coding Initiative, the Thesaurus Lingua Graca, which lives at your sister campus, UC Riverside. So if you're doing work that may be digitally inflected in some way, there's lots of different funding streams that you may come into the endowment for support for. And my job in the Office of Digital Humanities is to help you find the right funding opportunity. So many folks see the word digital and they say, oh, I have a digital project. I'm going to the Office of Digital Humanities. And my answer is always maybe. Let's find out. Tell me a bit more. What are you seeking funding for? Use this blog post though to get started as well. But let's jump into sort of what the Division of Research Programs can support. You are at a university. Most of you are sort of working and looking to support either your own research or looking to see, if not now, where in the future can your work be supported. The Division of Research Programs has a number of grant programs for individuals. And in fact, it's the only division at the endowment where we accept applications directly from individuals. And this work is often for research and writing, whether it be a fellowship, an award for faculty at Hispanic serving institutions, historically Black colleges and universities, tribal colleges and universities. And I know a number of the University of California campuses and the California State University campuses are now designated as high Hispanic enrollment or Hispanic serving institutions. So we have a special category like the fellowships, but just for faculty at those institutions called awards for faculty. Almost the same sort of a funding stream for research and writing, a bit more capacious to recognize the particular challenges that faculty at those institutions may have. But really, if you're looking for support for your own research and writing, same with summer stipends. Public scholars, if you have established a track record for writing for the public and are working on a monograph, perhaps even are under contract with a trade press and still need more time for that writing, the Public Scholars Program. And I do want to highlight one in particular, though. It's called the NEH Mellon Fellowships for Digital Publication. And we're now in the sixth and last year of this funding opportunity. The next deadline will be April 28th, so there's still time to prepare an application if you're interested in this. And this is a particular special stream of funding that we support. And when I say we, I mean both the Office of Digital Humanities, where I'm at, the Division of Research Programs, and additional support from the Andrew W. Mellon Foundation to support fellowships for projects that are going to be sort of born digital, that can only be done as a digital publication. So not a monograph that then is converted into a PDF and OCR'd and made available. No, it needs to be a bit more than that. It probably is going to incorporate some multimedia elements to make the arguments, to make the interpretive arguments that you're going to that you want to make. You need to incorporate sort of digital elements. And that's what this program is for, this funding stream is for. And we started it a few years ago because we were starting to get applications that were wanted to do just this, incorporate multimedia elements. A, they may not have had a publisher, and that made some of our panels a bit wary. They also, some of our panels didn't have the expertise necessary to review both the content and the approach. So we said, well, let's try to pull out some applications, some a program funding stream. There are now presses that are able to handle these sorts of work, and so that's a good sign. But now we needed to sort of prime the pipeline to get these projects underway. I suspect in the future we will be folding sort of this program back into our regular fellowships program. But for now, at least for one more year, we have a special pullout program. So if you're working on, and let me show you an example of one that was supported in 2018, and this one was at the University of Utah, and it's really a sound studies project. It's on American folk song in the 1930s. It's using an existing sound archive at the Library of Congress, but Professor Stone can't make his argument without having the sound incorporated into the publication. So this is an example of the types of projects that are tend to be supported: film studies, media studies, history of media studies, lots of literature projects as well that are incorporating media studies approaches as well. So take a look at this program if this is the sort of work that you're interested in doing, and perhaps have even been in conversation with a press about doing a digital first publication or a born digital publication. I do, though, of course, want to highlight sort of the work that we do. When I don't want folks to think that we only do digital first work across the endowment. That's certainly not true. And in fact, here's an example of someone from the University of California, Irvine, that was funded in 2011 on a wonderful topic. And it is really nice to see that from that comes this work. And in fact, the citation to this work is included in this grant products entry. This is an entry from the database of funded projects. And a little bit later, I'll show you where you can find that on the NEH website as well. I also want to point out, because we may have some folks in the audience from UC San Diego, one of your own colleagues just received a recent summer stipend award to write a chapter of a book. So if you need a shorter amount of time, you're not really expected to write a whole book during the summer, but working on a more discrete element is a good use of the summer stipends program. The other half of the Division of Research Programs is our grants for institutions. And when I say grants for institutions, I mean you work with your Office of Sponsored Programs or Research Administration. They submit the application on behalf of you and your colleagues who are preparing the application. They are almost always team projects, meaning multiple faculty and staff working on a project, often from multiple institutions, sometimes from colleagues from outside of the United States as well. A few things that I want to say about the Division of Research Programs, the institutional awards. If you haven't looked at collaborative research programs in a while, take a look at it. They have completely revamped the program in the last couple of years. There's now four different tracks, including preparing for international collaborations, another one just for digital first scholarly projects. So projects that are have a really heavy digital component as part of it. They have a special stream there for that sort of work. So there's four different streams. And so you'll want to make sure you take a look at that program. If you thought you knew what collaborative research supported in the past, you'll want to take a look again. Same with scholarly editions and translations. Much more information in the guidelines themselves, in the notices of funding opportunity, about sort of digital projects. And an entirely new grant program, they've just had their first deadline and are about to announce the first awards, they should be doing that in the next few weeks, is our Archaeological and Ethnographic Field Research Program. And it's a very capacious program in terms of field research, traditional archaeology field research, but ethnographic field work, including qualitative studies, including oral history projects with an interpretive component. So definitely, if you thought NEH didn't fund that, or you thought, oh, they fund so few, take a look at this program as well. And the final program here on this list is called Fellowships Programs at Independent Research Institutions. And I leave it on here, not because the University of California is an independent research institution, but because many folks in the audience of these workshops may want to know about the offerings that are supported through this program. And the independent research institutions are places like the Huntington, down in where you are in Southern California, but also the Newberry, the American Academy in Rome, other overseas institutions as well. So if you're doing work that you need time, once again, maybe to use the collections of that particular institution, there is a list on the NEH website. Some are short term, some are long term, some are just for primarily research and writing. Others are, if you've already are going to be working in that country and you need a home base, there may be fellowships opportunities for you. So make sure that you know about these. They're a hidden gem that can support a lot of really wonderful work across the globe, really, because there are these American overseas institutions as well. So a few examples, or at least one example, from Cal State Dominguez Hills. This is a scholarly edition that was funded not long ago. And I chose this one because it's a digital first edition. Catherine Sedgwick, it's her online letters project. They are sort of working on publishing this personal correspondence. So I don't want you to think also, many folks know about the Scholarly Editions and Translations program as, oh, that's our Founding Fathers program, or the founding, they only do certain types of projects that are sort of documentary editions. And I want to reassure you that the Scholarly Editions and Translations program is really welcoming to a range of different types of projects, smaller ones to really ones that we've now been supporting. The Mark Twain Project up in the University of California, Berkeley, I believe has been supported since 1976. So we have long-term ones. We also have much more discrete ones as well. So if you have a shorter editions project, this is the program for you as well, particularly if you're working as a team on this project. I'm now going to move to my office. I'm going to jump ahead of some of my other colleagues in the other offices and divisions. I'm going to take the prerogative as the workshop leader to spend a little bit of time talking about the offerings of my division. And I do want to reassure you, when we talk about digital humanities, we don't have a definition that would leave anyone out. We talk about both sides of the coin. We talk about harnessing or using new technology for humanities research, but we also want to study digital culture from a humanistic perspective. We want to do both sides. It's important that there's space for that at the NEH. So if you're doing that sort of work, particularly in conjunction with folks from computer science or information science, you'll find a home in the Office of Digital Humanities. And I'm going to talk a little bit about one particular grant program in particular, the Digital Humanities Advancement Grant Program. It's our project-based one, and it can do a lot of different things, in part because there's three levels of funding. So depending where you're at in your project, from just getting started to really working on a prototype at the level two stage to really sort of thinking about sustainability, broadening the audience for your project that may be appropriate for a level three project, really with an emphasis on innovation or creativity or bringing together people who normally don't work together, and you need some space for a workshop to talk about new and emerging methodologies and best practices. If there's pockets of work happening really around the world and you need some time for that sort of work to buy some of your time, the Office of Digital Humanities, and in particular the Digital Humanities Advancement Grant Program, may be the right program for you. And let me just say a word about this picture on this slide. This is what our database used to look like. It was all these different cards. And this card from 1975 is from a project where the word hypertext was first used. And it was actually an award to a computer scientist working, Andy Van Dam at Brown University, working with a literature scholar there. And they made a film about the project. And in fact, Andy Van Dam has gone on to send a lot of students to work at Pixar. And in fact, there are some that say Andy from the Toy Story movies possibly could have been named after him. That may be an apocryphal story. But I love that we found this card. We were doing a project on early computational projects, the Office of Digital Humanities was, and this one came to light and everyone had forgotten about it. We found the film, we contacted him, he still had a copy of the film. Now you can see the film on YouTube. So I always like to highlight this this particular image. I'm not gonna talk about all the images on all my slides, but this is one that I just love to share to talk about sort of the work that the NEH has done over the years in what now might be called the digital humanities, but we've always been in that space. And here's an example of an early stage, level one, just funded our last round, University of California, Los Angeles. It's a workshop and to build a network on digital mapping methods for scholars in Latinx studies. So they put together a wonderful application. The panel said, yeah, this is a space where there's pockets of innovation, but more work needs to be done. And we think that's a good day. That's a good use of endowment funds. So this is an example of what a level one may support. And of course, I know Deanna's in the audience. I want to highlight her work that she's doing. She received a level two award for the Virtual Studiolo project and the Isabella de Este project. They put together a really wonderful application. And in fact, here is the website and a wonderful sort of introduction to the project as well. If those of you who are unfamiliar with this project, you should definitely take a look at it just to get a sense of sort of what is really innovative work in incorporating sound and objects in a space. So it's really sort of working on 3D environment, but really, but asking really important humanities questions and really pushing the scholarly field as well as the technical field. So it's a team-based project. It includes scholars and technical experts from Italy as well. And it's a good example of what a level two is. They had done some work, but they needed additional funds to continue to work on the project, still experimenting in some ways. That's what a level two is for. So those are two examples, a level one and a level two, that can be supported through the Digital Humanities Advancement Grant Program. For those of you who are just sort of dipping your toes in the digital humanities or are thinking about, well, I'm not sure where the work that I do fits. I really wish I could learn more about what's happening out there, meet some other folks who are also sort of doing work in this space. We have things that are called the Institutes for Advanced Topics in the Digital Humanities, which is our what I call our professional development program. It is a program that is modeled on the Seminars and Institutes program in our Division of Education Programs, where I spent many years. And it's a recognition that bringing together folks working with the leaders in the field, whatever they're doing, whether it be spatial archaeology, whether it be natural language processing, whether it be cultural analytics in the humanities, there's value in bringing people together, whether it be virtually these days or face-to-face, which eventually we'll go back to, building a community so that when you go back to your campus and you begin to continue to work on your own project and you hit a roadblock, you have a community out there that you can continue to work with. Projects, collaborative projects bubble up from these sorts of work. And over the years, lots of NEH-funded projects have gotten their start at one of these Institutes for Advanced Topics in the Digital Humanities. And in fact, the University of Southern California has served as a host for a number of these over the years. UC Irvine did as well. It's also an opportunity for those of you who are at campuses like UC Irvine. In fact, all of you are probably at campuses where you are leaders in something, whether it be some aspect of the digital humanities, where you may in fact want to serve as a host. You want to share your expertise with a broad community of faculty and staff and what I call humanities professionals, advanced graduate students doing work in this space. So you can apply to attend one of these, and some of these happen during the summer, some of them happen throughout the year. Some of them, like the Foundations and Applications of Cultural Analytics, have a large online course that anyone can take, and then a smaller course just for advanced graduate students who've completed that online course as well. So there's lots of different models out there. So if you're thinking of, oh, I'd like to lead one of these, but I don't want to devote 2 weeks in the summer to it, I can't do that. Think about what could you do for a series of workshops across over a year or two. What if you partnered with another campus or another institution and you hosted it sometimes and they hosted it sometimes? So which is to say that we've consciously designed this program for directors to be as flexible as possible. Now's the time to start thinking about it. The next deadline will be in March of 2022 to direct, but it's not too early to take a look at the guidelines to see what other projects have been funded in the past and to get in touch with us to talk about leading one of these. It's also never too early to take a look at sort of what's been supported to see if there's still openings in any of these, to see if, to look at ones that have been supported in the past. Many of them have kept their sites up with their reading list. They've often recorded some of their speakers. So you can still, in some ways, benefit from the funding of these projects. In fact, earlier today, I was attending the website launch of an institute that was supported 2 years ago, and now they're launching the website that the participants have built on Caribbean Studies and Digital Humanities that was hosted by the University of Florida. So if you're interested in either sharing your expertise or growing your expertise in the digital humanities or some element of the digital humanities, the Institutes for Advanced Topics is the program for you. And finally, a word about our newest program in the Office of Digital Humanities, which is a partnership that we do with the Arts and Humanities Research Council of the UK. It's called New Directions for Digital Scholarship and Cultural Institutions. Once again, it's a program that has multiple levels of funding, in this case, two levels for planning and then for implementation. It's also a recognition that this sort of work in the digital humanities benefits from international collaboration. And in this case, there has to be one team from the United States and one team from the United Kingdom. There could be other teams involved, but the requirement for this program is at least two teams and at least one cultural institution. And that, in this case, we mean archives, libraries, museums, often university museums, working with collections, and exploring sort of the impact of digital methods and digital research on cultural institutions. And that's extremely broadly considered. The next deadline will be in July. So now's the time to sort of maybe get in touch with possible collaborators in the UK, take a look at projects that were funded the first round. That deadline in July will be the second round that we're going to be hosting this competition. I'm pleased to see that there was a project funded at USC on mapping and using maps during the very first round. So if this is something that might be of interest to you, particularly if you already have established relationships in the UK or established relationships with museums, libraries, archives, and want to explore the possibilities, this is another funding. And the way this works is NEH funds the US team and AHRC funds the UK team. We hold a joint review competition and the panelists sort of agree that this project is worth funding, and then we fund the US side of the project. So now that I'm going to move from the Office of Digital Humanities to the Division of Education Programs, where I spent quite a long time of my NEH career working on what was then some of the early digital funding programs. But I want to highlight some programs that may be of interest to you, particularly if you do work in teaching and learning. One that is the most flexible is the Humanities Initiatives Program. And as you can see by the way they describe their mission, strengthen the teaching and study of the humanities at institutions of higher education. New programs, new resources, courses, or enhancing existing ones. And one nice element of this program is it has separate streams for different types of institutions, including community colleges, Hispanic-serving institutions, tribal colleges, and more broadly, colleges and universities. If you don't fit into some of those other streams, there is a broader colleges and universities category. I also want to ask, I don't think there's anyone from community colleges here, but if any of you sort of know faculty and staff at community colleges, if you could slide this program in front of their eyes, that would be really helpful. We really want to make sure we are reaching community colleges, in part because so many students either take their last course in the humanities at a community college or become interested in the humanities while at a community college. And when they transfer, they're wonderful students for humanities courses. So a joint project led by a community college and one of the California State Colleges or UC or University of Southern California, that's a possibility as well. So partnerships, collaborations. So take a look at if you're not sure sort of what you want to do, if it doesn't fit anywhere else, but you're interested in a project in teaching and study of the humanities, take a look at the Humanities Initiatives Program. Another program that we have is called the Humanities Connections Program. And it's really focused on the humanities and undergraduate education. But a particular signature of this program is that it requires that the application include at least one program or department outside of the humanities. And that can include the law program, or if you have a medical program, or a nursing program, or a computer science program. If you have not had an opportunity to work with your colleagues in those programs, but are interested, say, in developing a certificate program, or an undergraduate minor, or even a major, or a series of courses, the Humanities Connections Program, we really feel very strongly that we needed to have a particular funding stream like the Humanities Connections Program to encourage that intercampus collaboration that you often, we're so busy, you all are so busy, and certainly last year was not something we'd ever want to repeat again, but to take a moment to breathe, to work, to study together, to work collaboratively with your colleagues on your own campus, the Humanities Connections program might be the program for you. So let me just highlight a couple of ones. This is one of those Humanities Connections programs that I mentioned. This is the ones at UCLA. And it's developing, a freshman interdisciplinary course sequence on the Middle East and North Africa. So it's a wonderful melding of social sciences and the humanities. So lots of different departments that are coming together. It includes staff from the library, from the writing program, also experiential learning partners. So lots of different folks coming together. But this is a planning grant, so it's fairly small. But it gives faculty time to do this. It pays faculty to do this instead of doing something else. So this is an example of one that was funded at the planning stages. And I also want to highlight a Humanities Initiatives program. And this one's at UC Riverside. So it is creating new medical and health humanities programs. So, and it will include sort of folks from their medical school. It will include elements of narrative medicine. I think it's a really exciting sort of example of how broad the Humanities Initiatives program can do. So definitely, if you're working sort of in any part of improving the pedagogy of the humanities on your campus, or sort of working, perhaps even working with community partners, the Humanities Initiatives program also can allow for working with community partners. Definitely take a look at those two funding opportunities. And finally, in the education division, I want to point out our summer programs. Some of you may have attended some of them. Some of you even may have thought, well, I could lead one of these. I'm a leader in this opportunity. So I want to make sure, so just move these dates. So February 2020 for projects in 2023. And participants, they just had their deadline to attend some of these, although I've noticed that some of the summer institutes in particular have extended their deadline for application. So if you thought, oh, I just missed the deadline, if you take a look at the list on the NEH website, you can see if some of them have extended the deadline for them. But what these are professional development opportunities to recharge, to continue to work on your own research and writing, perhaps at an institution that has access to tremendous libraries. The last this summer and last summer, a lot of these did move online. So you didn't get the opportunity to meet face-to-face, but you still had an opportunity to build a community and a network of like-minded folks working on similar sorts of work. It's been really actually heartening to see the sort of excellent work that's been happening in this space in an unintended move to the virtual. But let me just show you some examples of ones that have been funded in the past, just to whet your appetite, either to lead one or to participate in one. And this is one that was hosted by the University of California, Santa Cruz, but it was actually held in Washington, D.C. And it was on museums as sites of cultural meaning. So it could bring together folks working in a lot of different disciplines. And that's really the intent of many of these institutes, is to work across disciplines as well. Which is not to say that they can't sort of be focused on literature or philosophy. That's also the case as well. You don't have to be all things to all people, but a topic like museums, humanities in the public sphere, is an example of a really broad, appealing topic that can be supported through the institute's program. And this one was for college and university teachers. And this is an example of a Landmarks of American History and Culture for school teachers. And it was hosted by Cal State University Long Beach. And it was taking advantage of the fact that the Cold War home front in Southern California was extremely important. And California State University Long Beach was well positioned to sort of lead a summer institute. And I think this one actually got to meet in person because it was in summer of 2016. But I want to encourage you all to think about what are some of the other landmarks that Southern California, where you're at, can offer as an object of study. I can think of lots, having gone to school in Southern California. Certainly at UC Irvine, James Irvine, the development of the suburbs in Southern California, suburban development, what are you strong in on your campus? What do you have sites of institutes on that you may be interested in maybe hosting this for school teachers? Really sort of showing the possibility. It's also a great opportunity to highlight your campus to school teachers who will then go back and tell their students what a wonderful campus it is and that they should consider applying to attend college there. And finally, I want to speak a little bit about the Office of Challenge Grants because it's a special program. The funding streams are quite different from the rest of the endowment. But for those of you who are thinking long-term, and we all should be thinking long-term right now, if this last year has taught us nothing, it's the importance of sustainability and the importance of having humanities infrastructure that we can count on when things happen that we weren't expecting and we want the library to be well supported. We want the Humanities Institute to be well supported. The Office of Challenge Grants is the place to do that. It offers matching grants. So different from the rest of the agency where often the awards are outright funds. Sometimes you have to raise a little bit of matching funds, but the Challenge Grant program is really to encourage institutions to think about how can I raise funds to support the humanities on our campus? And can I use an NEH Challenge Grant to leverage other funds for capital projects? Are you renovating your library and wanting to build a new digital scholarship center and need to purchase furniture and equipment and software? Or do you host a long-term, long-standing digital project that other institutions, other faculty, staff, students, the general public have come to rely upon? And you need to think about long-term sustainability for that project. So two streams for this program, two deadlines a year for this program now as well. But if your campus is undertaking a capital campaign, or if you have a donor who needs a naming opportunity in the humanities, think about the Challenge Grant program. Often the application comes not from the Office of Sponsored Programs, but maybe your Office of Fundraising. So if you could slide this program in front of them to make sure that they're aware of it, so that they know that it's not just the sciences that need long-term infrastructure support, it's the humanities as well. And that the NEH actually has a program to support this sort of work. So we've revamped this program in the last couple of years to focus on capital projects and digital infrastructure. And so we want to make sure that you're aware of these changes and that you help us get the word out to those who are charged with raising external funds for your campus through fundraising. I've seen some really creative fundraising campaigns to match an NEH Challenge Grant as well. So it's a great opportunity to highlight the great work of the humanities that are happening on your campus at the campus level. And one project, as an example of digital infrastructure, is the Humanities Commons project. If you're not aware of it, you should be aware of it. hcommons.org. It's a project that started in the Office of Digital Humanities and then moved on to the Challenge Grants to secure its long-term future. So, but it's also a site that you as scholars, as graduate students, as humanities professionals, you should have a profile on the Humanities Commons site. It's a networking site. It's not like, it's much more than LinkedIn, I have to say, but it's also a way to share your work, to discover other scholarship, to see what others are doing. It's not just digital humanities as well. There's groups on East Asian humanities, on Renaissance studies, on Slavic studies. So take a look at this if you're not familiar with it. Create your own profile. But it's an example of another sort of longstanding digital infrastructure project that needs longstanding support as well and was supported by a challenge grant. Okay, so I've talked about NEH funding programs. Now I'm going to take another ask you to have a quick reaction. How many are you familiar with the work of the State Humanities Council, California Humanities? Let's see how many hands are being raised. If you're not familiar, become familiar. California Humanities is one of 56 State Humanities Councils. It's one of the most creative councils, I think, that are out there. They do some amazing work. They have funding opportunities, particularly if you're working with community organizations. This is a great place to start, to build a track record often before you come to the NEH for additional support. In fact, Camp Crip, which was just nominated for an Academy Award, started with funding from the California Humanities Film Program. So if you are a filmmaker, if you know filmmakers, the California Humanities Council is one of those state councils that offers documentary film awards. But really take a look at sort of the range of funding opportunities, but also get involved in other ways. They're always looking for folks to partner with. You're all at institutions that have a lot of expertise in a lot of different areas, and that's what they're looking for. So you may be, if nothing else, join their mailing list so you can become aware of what they do in this space. They often have great opportunities where students can get involved as well with community organizations. So California Humanities Council is one of our largest councils, and they do some of the most creative work. So take a look at that program. Okay, now what? I've thrown a lot at you. So maybe you've jotted down some notes. This program seems interesting. I need to look further. How and where do you look further for funding? So here's the NEH homepage, NEH.gov. I'm going to sort of walk you through where to find things on the NEH website. At the very top, you'll see that the line where it says grants and news. We're going to go deep into the grants section. And two areas that I want to make sure you know about are the Search All Grant Programs and Search All Past Awards. These are the two buttons that we're going to spend most of our time looking at right now. So this is what you get when you search past awards. This is that database of funded projects that I pointed you to, that I was showing examples from. That's where I was drawing it from. So you can find out who's doing sort of projects in your space. It's a great place to find collaborators. It's also a place many of the NEH funding opportunities ask for an environmental scan or literature review as part of their project. This is a great database to find out who's doing work in this space already. And you'll want to refer to that. It's not the only place you should ever look for it, but it's a good place to start. It's also a place to start if you want to see what are some of the products and white papers that have been supported through this project. In the Office of Digital Humanities, in addition to the funding the project, we require all of our awardees to prepare what we call a white paper that's made available on the NEH website as one of the project products. So it's a recognition that what happens in the Office of Digital Humanities and digital humanities projects in particular, there's a great value to be found in describing the methods of the project, what worked and didn't work. We often in the humanities only see the completed book or the completed website, where it looks like everything succeeds all the time. And we want to encourage our projects to also talk about what didn't work and where the pain points are and how they got around them or how they went in a different direction. After being at the NEH for 27 years, I'm fairly sure we reinvented a wheel many times, but there was no good way to share that information with the broader public because we only had the final reports that stayed in our files and then went to the National Archives and stayed there for 25 years and then were destroyed. We always had sort of the books and the articles, the public-facing ones, but for projects that really had a lot of value, but maybe didn't go any further than the final report, there was really no way to share that information with the American public. And that's a waste. That's not a good use of tax dollars. We need to share that information as well. So now we have those public-facing white papers, so you can search those for. So that workshop that you saw on Latinx mapping, in addition to the workshop, there will be a white paper that will be available from the NEH for years afterwards that you can refer back to. So back to the grants page. So you've searched all past awards to see what's already happened in that space. Let's go to, then you click on search grant projects and you'll get a huge long list of different funding opportunities and you'll click on one of them. And this is what you'll find. This is what I call a landing page. And in fact, it's actually longer than what you're seeing here. I had to do a screen snip. But it's also, I wanted to point out a few things. All of our landing pages for our funding programs look the same. It's where you'll find the application deadlines. It's where you'll find out whether or not that particular program reads drafts. I always recommend that folks start work backwards from when funding can begin to really think about how do you plan for sort of what's going to happen in the interim as well. It's also where you'll see the webinar for that particular program, so a much deeper dive than I've been able to give during this workshop, or a place to sign up if the webinar is going to happen in the next few weeks. It's also where you will download the application materials. Every funding opportunity at the NEH has what's called a Notice of Funding Opportunity, or a NOFO. And that's what you need to read carefully and deeply. Use your humanity skills as a close reader. Make a note what programs can fund what activities. Different programs can fund different things. For example, the Digital Humanities Advancement Grant Program does not fund digitization of collections because we have another grant program that does elsewhere in the endowment. So make sure you not only find a program, you find the right program for the types of activities that you need support for. Nothing pains us more. Well, there's lots of things that pains us more, but it does pain us at the NEH if an application is submitted to what we think is the wrong program, where it would be much more competitive in a different grant program. But once it's submitted to a funding opportunity, we as NEH staff can't switch it to a different program. And then you'll also need to wait until you hear from the outcome of this particular funding opportunity before you submit an application elsewhere for the same activities. So it behooves you to get in touch with us beforehand. In all of the notices of funding opportunities are email addresses, telephone numbers to get in touch with us. And I want to encourage you to think that you should be doing that ahead of time. And I'll reinforce that in a couple of other places in this discussion as well. And of course, as you're reading the notice of funding opportunities, what you want to focus on is the evaluation criteria for that particular program. I'm not going to read the evaluation criteria for the Digital Humanities Advancement Grant Program. It's certainly, as I say, it's for illustration only, but each funding program has different evaluation criteria. Usually the humanities significance is the first one. We are the NEH, the National Endowment for the Humanities, of course. But I definitely want to make sure that you understand that you want to write your application with an eye toward the evaluation criteria. And in fact, we have keyed our evaluation criteria to different parts of the application. So as you're writing your application and following the instruction for the different components of the narrative, you will also see how which review criteria you're writing for that particular section. A few tips. They're probably fairly obvious, but I still feel they're important to say. Of course, find the right program, as I mentioned. Make sure you understand how grants.gov works, not only for the NEH, but if you're applying to any federal funding opportunity, grants.gov is probably one of the entry points for the National Endowment for the Humanities. It is the only entry point. Find out how the submission will work for that particular program. The submission for individual applications are slightly different than submissions for institutional awards. Make sure you read the guidelines and the samples. We make samples available of previously funded applications. Participate and watch those webinars. And of course, contact the NEH with questions. You now know me. I'll leave my contact information at the end of our discussion. If you're not sure who you should be speaking with, you can always write to me. I'm happy to facilitate an introduction to one of my colleagues elsewhere at the NEH as well. Another nice thing about being a small agency is I know most of my colleagues across the agency, and I'm happy to introduce you. We can do joint calls. If I'm not sure whether your project fits with one program or another, and sometimes it's the case that I need to check with my colleagues as well, I can set up a joint call and we can have a conversation together to help you find the right program for the right stage of your project as well. Things to think about when writing your application. Of course, write for both specialists and generalists. We always say avoid jargon, which is not to say if you're writing a technical project to avoid technical details. If there's a word or a term in your project that you're not sure everyone will understand, define it in the application. As I said, address the review criteria. Concrete examples are another way to really enhance your application. You want to give panelists confidence. You also want to give NEH staff confidence that you know what you're doing, because you're asking us to spend taxpayer dollars. We don't have a lot of them, so we want to have confidence, whether it's an early stage or whether this is a really long-standing project. It's still on you. We treat every application as brand new. And so you need to show us that you know where you've been and where you're going. and you want to anticipate and answer possible concerns, whether it be, oh, are they new to this this sort of work? Or why is this project still going on for so long? Why do they still need funding? You need to come at it from both sides of the coin. And of course, a few words about budget. Not everyone likes to talk about budget stuff, but if you're applying for an institutional award, you're going to be submitting a budget as part of your application. And so you want to make sure you consult the very detailed budget guidelines and samples. For different programs, know what is and isn't allowed. And make sure you talk to a program officer if you're not sure. I often have to then ask my Office of Grants Administration colleagues to also make sure. And of course, talk to your sponsored research program early in the process. Do not go to them the day before the application is due and ask them to submit the application on your behalf. There may be institutional policies that you don't know about in preparing the budget. They can help you apply the correct indirect cost rates to the right costs on your project. They are experts in this space. Treat them as the professionals they are. Bring them in early in the process in the conversations. They have a lot to offer you. They may be able to tell you to say this is allowed or this isn't allowed. We don't want you to be tripped up at the end of the process and have items removed from an approved budget because that particular item isn't approved. What we want to do is to have you work with your sponsored research office early, and if they have questions, they can get in touch with us as well. But for large scale projects or even a workshop where costs can be confusing, talk to your sponsored research office and have them help you and have them be part of the conversation and be a member of your team. And eventually they'll be submitting your application to grants.gov on behalf of the institution. So give them a heads up and don't bring them the application the day before or even the day of the application and have them say, can you submit this please? They may have other things on their plate. Make sure you're on their schedule. So once you submit your application, this is why it takes so long. Sometimes you may say, why? Gosh, I submitted my application in January and you're not telling me the results until August. This is why. This is how it works. We go from sorting applications to the chairman's decision. And by law, the chairman, or in this case right now, the acting chairman of the NEH, makes the final decision. So it's a little bit different than some other funding programs or even a private foundation. The chairman takes under advisement the peer review panels, which are made up like by folks like you, the staff recommendations who sort of bring together all of the different peer review panels, our National Council on the Humanities, and then he or she sort of takes a look at everything that's gone on before and can say, yes, these are the ones that I'm going to be supporting. And that's the name that goes on the check as well. So, but this is why it takes a long time. One of my NEH colleagues used to say, the wheels at the endowment grind slowly but exceedingly fine. So there's not enough money to fund all of the excellent projects. So some of these decisions are very hard, and that's why there's lots of eyeballs on it. So what happens after you hear the results of your application? If you got the award, congratulations. Now get to work. You're going to have to do what you said you're going to do. If you didn't get an award, I'm so sorry. It is often the case, as I said, that we don't have enough funds to support all of the excellent projects that are out there. It is also the case that sometimes a small tweak to a project might bring it into the fundable range next time. So always, always, always request your reviewer comments. You'll get an email with the results of your of the competition. Just request the reviewer comments that way. Just respond right back and request the reviewer comments. Read them, set them aside, go back and read them again. Contact a program officer then, and then resubmit your application. Take into advisement. Having said that though, read those comments really closely. See where reviewers agreed. Sometimes reviewers disagree as well. Take what's meaningful to you and say, oh, I could have addressed that. It was obvious to me, and obviously it wasn't obvious to the reviewers. How can I revamp this application so it's obvious to the reviewers as well? But it is the case, certainly in the Office of Digital Humanities, applications that are revised and resubmitted, have a slightly higher chance of being funded than the first time. The record in my office for revise and resubmit is 6 times. And that was pretty exciting, although we had to maintain a poker face throughout the whole thing. They benefited from 25 external reviewers to improve the project. And let me just tell you, the project was much improved the 6th time around. It is discouraging. Some of our funding programs have a 10% funding ratio. That's not great, but we don't want you to go away. We want you to stay with us. If not with this particular project that you're working on, maybe at a different project later on in your career as well. The NEH should always be sort of part of how you're thinking about how you can have your work supported. So let me say a few words about the American Rescue Plan. It was just signed not too long ago, but the NEH was thrilled to receive $135 million as part of it. There will be several funding streams that will come out of it that will be announced hopefully in the next few weeks. Colleges and universities will be part of that, so keep an eye on that as well. Find out who will be submitting the application on behalf of your institution. If you have some ideas that need to be supported, particularly efforts that have been curtailed by COVID-19. What are you not doing because COVID-19 got in the way? What are staff that are not being supported or in danger of not being supported? That's what these funds are for. It's emergency economic relief. So what sort of projects can be supported or work that needs to be supported? So keep an eye on the NEH, if nothing else, to see what's happening with that. The state councils will also be getting additional funds through the American Rescue Plan to NEH. So the California Humanities Council will have even more funds available to support work in this space. So if you are working on a project, or maybe you are working with a small local historical society, make sure they know about that these funds are on the way as well. We know there's been a lot of revenue lost because of COVID-19, and particularly smaller cultural institutions without a deep funding fundraising bench are hurting a lot right now. Make sure that they're aware that the state humanities councils are also a source of support for them. And finally, a couple of things to keep up with NEH activities, special initiatives and events. Make sure your dean's office and your office of sponsored programs or projects knows what you're working on. So if a new initiative from the NEH or a new grant program comes down the pike, they know that it's for you and they can slide that program in front of you. Follow NEH accounts on social media, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, whatever's your preferred flavor. We have accounts on all of them, LinkedIn. Sign up for our newsletters. We try not to bombard you with too much information, but particularly around this time when we announce new awards, when exciting things happen like Academy Award nomination for one of our projects, and also when new funding opportunities or special initiatives. We have a new administration. We're going to have a new chair one day. Usually NEH chairs come up with special initiatives that they want to focus the endowment on. So we want to make sure that you're aware if additional funds become available, targeted areas of funding, and it may be a targeted area that you're working on, that you know and can take advantage of that opportunity. And where can you sign up for them? So if you go to the NEH homepage and scroll all the way down to the bottom, you'll see these little social media links. The little envelope down at the bottom is to sign up for the newsletters and, of course, the other places as well. The YouTube account is where you can see all of our webinars as well for all of the different programs. And one more thing before we move to questions. I want to invite you all to sign up to serve as peer reviewers. And it's right here under that grants page, right there where it says become a peer reviewer. We are committed to always having fresh sets of eyes to serve as peer reviewers. The range of projects that we are seeking reviewers for is enormous and growing. And we don't want to always have the same 5 people reviewing a proposal. We want to reassure applicants that you're not going to have the same reviewers that you had previously if you're revising and resubmitting. We also are going to need reviewers for the American Rescue Plan funding opportunity. We need to share the wealth and the responsibility of serving as a peer reviewer. It's also a great opportunity to get a behind the scenes look at how decisions are made at the endowment to see how the review process works. Some of our review panels, meet virtually. Others are just what we call mail out panels, where really you just submit your reviews to our online review system. So you don't have to commit to coming to Washington, D.C. anymore. Most of our panels, in fact, are virtual ones. We ask you to read applications usually 6 weeks ahead of time and then to meet for a day with your fellow panelists. But it's a great way to sort of participate in the process, to give back, to get that service credit that you need, possibly for your review, your own personal review. But it's also a great way of putting in stronger applications as well, to get a sense of what works and what doesn't work and what reviewers really do focus on. So that's the NEH in a nutshell, a very large nutshell. Here's my contact information. I want to make sure that you feel comfortable writing to me, but also take a look at the NEH website, delve deeply into the resources that we've made available. We've worked hard to be as transparent as possible over the years. You used to have to know to ask for a sample application, for example, and certain institutions knew to ask for them to give to their faculty or to their staff. Others didn't. And now we've just made it all available for everyone. I also want to reassure you that getting in touch with us ahead of time is not cheating. It always breaks my heart when folks say, oh, I had a question, but I didn't want to bother you. That's what you pay me for, to bother me. That's my job, is to help you sort of navigate the NEH. And I want you to feel comfortable doing that. So, but I think we have some time for questions now. If anyone wants to ask some questions, I'll stop sharing my screen as well, and I'll just be a giant head in the screen as well. So I think we are. Oh, thank you for putting that contact information, Ryan, in the screen. So, I see that Amanda has also been adding some highlights of take a look in there as well. So, yes, Amanda, thank you. Yes, I don't have to be the only conduit for you to write to NEH. Every program has an email address, and every program officer, program assistant, program analyst wants to help you just as much as I do. We are committed to the mission of the NEH, and we have not seen each other for a whole year. It's now been a year and a day. So I did have a question about NEH applicants working with an international team member on a project. So it's a little tricky because the NEH cannot fund international institutions. So we can't fund the University of Bologna, for example, or an institution in Australia. What we can do, though, is support scholars outside of the United States as scholarly consultants on a project. I want you to sort of, at least that's the case now. It may change in the future. It's certainly something we have encouraged our hires up to take a look at. But for right now, the NEH cannot give a sub-award, or cannot give an award to an institution in the United States that then gives a sub-award to an international organization. But I want to encourage you to think about who are the right people that should be on your project. And if the right people are outside of the United States, you can pay them for their time as scholarly consultants on the project. International institutions can be subcontractors, but that's a little bit tricky. That's usually for, if you're on an archaeological dig and you're paying for drivers or you're paying for the catering for that, that's a subcontract. But for international collaboration, intellectual collaboration, that's not what a subcontract is for. That's really what a sub award would be for an institution. Say if UCI is working with the University of California, Berkeley, and one institution has to be the head, the applicant of record, and then they give a sub-award to UC Berkeley. In this case, a sub-award cannot go to an international institution, but international participants can be part of the project. For the we've also tried to address it with these international funding partnerships where the funding organizations come together, like the NEH and the the Arts and Humanities Research Council of the UK, where the United States funds the US part of it and the HRC funds the UK part of it. So, but it's a joint project. The project could not be done if both partners weren't together. And so it takes a lot of work on our end to put together those funding streams. There's a lot of, well, what's required, what's nice to have, to put out a funding call. But it's also another way where two teams can be funded from two different countries as well. So that's another way that we try to support international work. And I can tell you that international work is one of our priorities at NEH. So we really want to make sure that you know that international work can be supported. Just we want to make sure the way the funding flows matches up with what we're permitted to do. So I hope that makes sense. It's a little bit tricky, and that's why we ask you to call us if you have any questions about how a particular program might support international work as well. So I have another question in the chat. It says, if we have several ideas and are interested in brainstorming with a knowledgeable person, what first steps would you recommend? Well, my first recommendation is to put some things down on paper, some ideas. And take a look at the NEH funding opportunities and see if there's ones that you think might be a good match. And then if there are several from several different projects that all might fit in with, say, collaborative research, reach out to the collaborative research program. But if you're just really not sure, you certainly can write to me. You can talk to Amanda. If you're at the University of California, Irvine, Amanda is really very well versed in NEH funding opportunities. There might be someone on your campus that you can talk to about. I do want to sort of note that you can have multiple applications for different types of projects happening at the same time. Don't overextend yourself though. A, what happens if you get all of the awards? And B, you do have to be careful. You can't be asking for more than 100% of your salary across different grant programs. That is something that we do have to check at the time of application. So be judicious in how you think and think strategically about sort of who should be leading what types of projects. But put some things down on paper. It's really helpful for me when I'm talking to someone, when I'm sort of helping them find the right NEH grant program, is to know, what do you want to use the funds for? Is it to support people? Is it to buy equipment? Is it to travel? And what are your intended outcomes? What do you hope to sort of have as an outcome as well? And that often helps me figure out which are the various NEH grant programs might be a possibility for you. I hope that's helpful. Let's see, what's another question here? Let me go down. There's Sarah's question. And a question from Sean. Regarding the Digital Humanities Advancement Grants, what advice can you offer on deciding to apply for a level 2 versus a level 3? Level 2 gives you more flexibility. There's greater expectations the further you go up the chain. We give comparatively fewer level 3s. Those are the big awards. Your project already needs to have a track record. You need to have an audience beyond the initial team of the project. The level 2 gives you more space to experiment, to innovate, to build that audience. But it's a good sort of, that's sort of the higher level, the meta. So to think about level 2 versus level 3. But for a particular project, it is often best discussed with a program officer. You'll probably want to demonstrate that you have something, and panelists will want to see if you're applying for level 3. They'll definitely want to see a track record of some sort. What other external funding have you already received? Is the team in place? Do you have a track record of working together on this particular project? I often tell someone, applying for a level 3 as your first external funding is probably strategically not a great idea. Build a track record of external funding with a level 1 or a level 2 or funding from another funding stream, maybe outside of the NEH. Show that others have already sort of bought into your project. Because the level 3, you're not only going to be asked about sort of what are you doing, but you're also going to be asked, how are you going to sustain this project? You need to show that this project is worthy of sustaining. So that's in some ways a way to think about level 2, level 3. Level 2 gives you more opportunities to fail. We don't want to fail with a lot of taxpayer dollars, but it's okay to it's okay to perhaps fail or at least be productively challenged at a level two in a way that the level three might not sort of give you that space, because there's so many other details that need to come into it. Another question. I'm in the drama department. We are looking for funding for moving lights and sound for one of our theaters. Would this fit under capital projects? I have to say probably not. Although I want to have you talk with my colleagues in the Office of Challenge Grants, because the theater is probably primarily for an arts-based project rather than humanities projects, you'd really have to make what's the humanities use case for the theater? How is it used for that sort of work? It might be a challenge, but it's always worth having a conversation with them. The only thing they can say is, I'm sorry, I don't think it's a good fit. I don't recommend you applying. And then we've saved you some time from applying. I know that the NEH used to actually have a parallel program to this, but they don't have it anymore. And I think they're missing out on being able to support this sort of work. I'm glad we still have this opportunity to think about these sorts of things. But Mary, I want to encourage you to reach out to my colleagues in the Office of Challenge Grants. They've just put up the notices of funding opportunities. Take a look at how they address that arts humanities challenge. You're not the only one to have that question. Spaces often are used for cultural activities broadly considered. Then how do you make the case for the humanities in it? It's worth asking, if only to get a polite no, and maybe some suggestions on where else they might recommend for support. Okay, so let me see, we have another question here. I am working with Howard University Alumni Scholars, and one current faculty member is on an application for level one funding. The funds will be used to seed a Howard University Film Archive and more a long-term, a Center for Cinematic Arts and Cultural Memories. Is it possible for alumni scholars from other, so the question is it possible for alumni scholars from other domestic institutions to serve as co-principal investigators? And the shorter answer is for the Office of Digital Humanities, absolutely. And I think generally, yes, for other programs as well. You want to check the section of the Notice of Funding Opportunities that addresses who can be co-principal investigators for programs is addressed in the eligibility section. Different programs sometimes have different rules, and different institutions sometimes have different rules as well. Sometimes they don't permit PIs or co-PIs to be from outside of the institution. And that's not an NEH policy, that's a university policy. So that's what you also want to talk with the Office of Sponsored Research for the institution that will be submitting the application. But generally for the Office of Digital Humanities, it's fine for us. We've had projects that have five co-PIs from five different institutions. And that's a lot of cats to herd. But if that's the way you want to organize the project, that's perfectly fine as well. And certainly alumni, they can also be from different disciplines. They don't always have to be from the humanities. We've had very successful projects where someone from the library is a co-PI, someone from the computer science department or the information school is a co-PI. So whoever is going to be the intellectual heads of the project and is sort of taking responsibility. You not only get the glory of being the co-PI, you are responsible if the project goes sideways. And I'll tell you, this last year, a lot of projects went sideways through no fault of their own. And the co-PIs were the people responsible for bringing it back and to figuring out a plan B. I want to make sure that you know that there's a difference between being on a project and being paid from a project and being a co-PI. You get the glory, but you get the pain as well. So, Mary, let me just answer your question. I hope you're still there. The short answer is, I'm not sure. I don't think so. If it's primarily going to be for drama department productions, if it's going to be more in the arts side of things. But I want to encourage you to get in touch with my colleagues in the Challenge Grant office, because the only thing they can do is say no, and they might even know where else you might seek funding support for the work. I know the NEH doesn't have a funding stream like the Challenge Grant program. They used to. When I first started in the government, they did, but they no longer. But colleagues across the NEH are really tapped into sort of other funding streams as well. We always try to keep an eye on who else is funding work in the digital humanities, so we can also refer you to some other programs as well. But for what you're doing, the capital infrastructure, the Challenge Grant program is the place at the NEH. I'm just not sure what you need support for can be supported through the Challenge Grant program, because it may be just far enough outside of the humanities that it may not work. But it's worth asking. So any other questions about how to think about the NEH, how to assemble a team? Let's see. Oh, good. Thanks, Mary. I'm glad that worked. Now you don't have to pull up the recording and scroll all the way through until we get to your question. Things to think about. Projects in the Office of Digital Humanities in particular are often stronger if they don't start and stop with one particular institution. Use this as an opportunity to bring collaborators from outside of your institution together. That's what outside funding is supposed to do. Why do you need to go to the NEH? Why do you need to go through the trouble of seeking NEH support? And we are not unaware that you have to jump through lots of hoops to even just apply to NEH. So make the bang for the buck really, really strong, particularly if you're coming to, say, collaborative research, or you're coming to digital humanities advancement grants. I also want to say a word about sort of library collections and special collections, whether you're using them, whether you represent them and are within this this workshop. We have lots of funding opportunities where librarians are a key member of the team, whether it be through the preservation and access division, where many of the funding streams are specifically for preservation of special collections, digitization of collections, or whether it be in the Digital Humanities Advancement Grant. They are a key member of the team, adding their own expertise and helping you also plan for sustainability, even at the beginning of a project. Make sure that their expertise is represented on your project and that they're compensated for their work as well. They bring a lot to the table. And certainly in the digital humanities, librarians are a key group that's doing really
look like to
really exciting and innovative. You have me here, and if anyone wants to, and I think you can put it in the chat. Ryan, I don't know if you're able to unmute folks as well if they just want to ask.
Yeah, everybody's unmuted. So if you'd like to raise your hand, you know, by all means, you can ask your question verbally as well. Jennifer, I do want to note really quick that you did kind of freeze up there for a moment, just a moment ago. So any thoughts you had there, if you wanted to repeat those.
Well, my takeaways are, stay in touch with us. Because the NEH is going to be announcing some American Rescue Plan opportunities, and we're going to have a new chair soon as that person is nominated and confirmed by the Senate. They might have some new initiatives. Always take a look back at programs that you thought you knew. They may have changed over time. And of course, sign up to be a peer reviewer. We need you. You're part of the process of supporting the humanities in the United States. So, I want to make sure that you, and if you're a graduate student on this call, more kudos to you. You're not eligible at this time to be a PI on a project, or you're not eligible to be to apply for a fellowship, but you're already ahead of the game and thinking about how, reading these guidelines, knowing what funding agencies are looking for. That's half the battle. And if you're doing that early, you're ahead of many of your fellow graduate students. So I appreciate you being on here, and we hope that NEH can be part of your career as it grows over time as well, whether or not you choose to stay in academia. We have a historic costume collection and want to digitize the pictures of the garments. Absolutely, Mary. That is a wonderful example of our preservation and access division and their funding opportunities, and in particular, the Preservation Assistance Grants Program, and then to maybe do a survey of the collection to look at the physical surroundings of the collection, and then to digitize the collection, the Humanities Collections and Reference Resources Program. So yes, we have two programs that might be of interest to you through that Division of Preservation and Access, which I didn't talk about at all during this workshop, in part because it's yet another funding stream that might be available to you. And it's very detailed in what they can and can't fund, but digitizing collections, digitizing images from the collection and making them available is absolutely something that can be supported and has been supported. Historic costume collections have been supported by humanities collections and reference resources in the past. Can you remind us when holders of NEH grants are eligible to apply for another grant? Well, a lot of it depends. You can be a PI or a co-PI on an existing award and apply for another award. Panelists often like to see projects that are coming to a conclusion or are done before they're willing to sort of take a chance on another one. If you're a fellow, you need to finish your fellowship. You can't be an NEH fellow and a co-PI in another project at the same time. When you're thinking strategically about how to sort of stage out your projects, when you think about when to next apply, it is what can you talk about from your previous award? What can you show to them? Can you convince the peer review panels that you're ready for next stages of funding as well? I always try to tell my current project director cohort, don't get an NEH award and immediately turn around and submit another application. Even though we know you want to keep the funding flowing, panels are often reticent, and they say, I'm not willing to take a chance on this one until I see what's happened in their previous one as well. So that it works better when certain programs have two deadlines a year rather than one. But so as you think about sort of how to stage out your project as well, keep an eye on sort of the application deadlines for the next round as well. So does that make sense, Dina? Let's see. But it is certainly the case that if you're on 20% of your salary on one NEH award and you have an entirely different project, say you're applying, you have a digital humanities advancement grant and you're applying for an entirely different humanities initiatives for faculty at colleges and universities, there's nothing that would prevent you from receiving two different awards. You just have to be able to manage two different awards as well. And that's a lot of work. And there's, as you know, Dina, there's a lot of virtual paperwork that comes with managing NEH awards as well.
I do know that. Thank you.
Sure. I really want to thank you all. I know people say, oh, we're coming out of the pandemic. Yeah, we're not coming out of the pandemic anytime soon. We still have a long way to go, and you all must be exhausted. I certainly know I am, and so I really appreciate you all coming and listening to me. I hope I've whetted your appetite and encouraged you, if nothing else, to follow follow the NEH and to keep up with what we're doing. Because if not now, you may not have energy right now to write an NEH grant application, and that's okay. But keep us in mind for next year or from 5 years from now. Knock on wood, we will be here when you're ready for us as well. So, don't hesitate to reach out with questions. If not now, I'm still a long way from retirement as well. And I have some wonderful Office of Digital Humanities colleagues as well. So if you don't want to write to me, you would prefer to write to odh@neh.gov, you're welcome to do that as well. We share that account. Please don't think you're sending an email off. And this is the case across the endowment. You're not sending an email off into the ether where there's no one on the other side of the box. Like when you're writing to customer service with some companies, you're thinking, is anyone ever reading this? If you write to an email address at neh.gov, someone, and often the case, five or six people are reading those emails, and we're trying to get back to you as quickly as possible. Sometimes it takes us a few days, but we'll get back to you, I promise.
I can vouch for that. I have sent emails to those generic email addresses at the NEH, and program officers turn around respond very quickly within a few days and make sure that I was directed to the right person and got my questions answered. So I just want to say that the NEH is a pleasure to work with. As with any federal agency, it is bureaucratic in the application and the reporting procedures. This is true, but in terms of the people, I always enjoy working with the NEH program officers. And yes, I encourage everyone to contact them if you have questions, if you're not sure which would be the best grant program to apply to, because they are very helpful. They want to help before you submit, so that we're submitting the strongest applications that we can. Yeah. So, Jennifer, thank you so much.
It was my pleasure.
We really, really appreciate you giving us all this information and answering questions and just helping us have a better understanding of the NEH and just all of the resources and money. And we wish you had more money.
Yes, well, and if someone says, can you be a talking head on my documentary? One day you may be an Academy Award nominated talking head on a documentary. Say yes. If they say, oh, can you be a visiting scholar on this institute that we're applying for? Consider saying yes, but don't forget to ask to be included in the budget too. Your work is worthy of being supported. And NEH has money to support that work. So whether it be as an applicant or as a consultant on a different project. So that's what we want to do. Well, so thank you all.
We appreciate your work personally, and also the work of all your colleagues at the NEH. And so we appreciate the NEH funding that we've received at UCI, and I know at these other institutions that have joined us. And we look forward to getting more money from you in the future. So,
yes, if not now, in the future. Yeah, and I want to say also hi to Jana from Chapman University. I see her here.
I met Jana. UCI PhD.
Yes,
also.
Absolutely. Of course, I did know that. I met Jana at one of those Institutes for Advanced Topics in the Digital Humanities, I think years and years and years and years ago. So. I'm so glad that you were able to join us for this. So hi.
I think it was 11 years ago.
But. Yeah, 11 years ago. Gosh.
Yeah. So Jana is our digital humanities, role model for UCI humanities graduate students. We're always like, look at what Jana has done.
And so, once you're part of the NEH family, we never let you leave, really. So we'll ask you to be a reviewer. There's lots of ways to be involved in this sort of work. So, and don't forget the California Humanities Council as well.
Yes, and at UCI, we have a great relationship. I posted the one exhibition is up in the gallery, but unfortunately, can't be open, but there's a virtual tour, and we have another faculty member with a current grant, and we've had other California grants as well. So. That we have a great relationship with
good,
them.
Good. That's important to maintain that relationship. Cool.
Well, thank you. Those of you who have stuck it out to the bitter end, thank you very much. And have a good afternoon. And Jennifer, you have a good evening because you're 3 hours ahead, and we will continue to be in touch.
All right. So. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.